morning, church. Welcome to our Sunday morning service. I want to invite you to worship with us here today. We're so grateful and so glad to be able to be together. Even if we're not together in the same room, we're still together. We're still together. We're watching together. We're going to worship together. We're going to listen to the word of God that He has prepared for us together. And we're going to start with some worship. There is joy in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Wind and for your love. Thank you, God, yes. Church, just take a moment and just thank God for his love, his grace and his mercy this morning, his healing power this morning, church. Thank you, God, that you love us. Despite the storms that we go through, no matter how deep the ocean may seem, God, you love us. You reach down to that deep, deep darkness. We can look up and see your light. And you pull us out of that, God. And we thank you. We thank you for your love this morning. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your healing. Church, this morning, as we just get ready to go into the announcements, just take that moment and say, God, thank you for your healing. Speak that over your life. Thank you for your healing. No matter what it is this morning, thank God for your healing this morning. God, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, worship team. Thank you guys for the blessing of just ushering us into the presence of God this morning. And so, church, good morning. Good morning, Facebook family, friends. We miss you guys. Good morning, everyone. You may have your seat. Those in here in church this morning. We're going to jump right into announcements. Continuing to announce that we do have the raffle that's taking place for the Christmas gift for either the handyman or the handywoman in your life. You can have a chance to win a 9-piece DeWalt toolkit, and you can enter the raffle for $25. The drawings will be held November 29th, we've been announcing, and you can purchase the tickets from Brother Robert or Nick Vasquez, and it is cash only. All proceeds will be going to our building fund. Along with that, we are having our Marriage Enhancement, which is selling the 2021 coupon book for $25 each. Proceeds also are going towards our building fund. So if you have any questions on that, you can see and reach out to Brother James and Sister Yoli. This morning, as we prepare our hearts in worship, the Lord gave me this. And if you get ready to get your tithe and offering this morning, even at home, we know that we can go online and continue to give that way, as many of us already do. Real quick, God gave me this, Proverbs 3:9-10. Give honor to the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruits of all your increase, so your storehouses will be full of grain and your vessels overflowing with new wine. And as I thought about that this morning, I know even though many of us are at home and we're having to watch online, the blessing of being able to continue to watch, continue to get together, like our brother Eddie said this morning, even if you're not here physically, God is exactly where you are right now. And so no matter what, I just encourage our church, continue to be giving, continue to be the blessing to our community, continue to be obedient to God's word. So this morning, as you give, of course, we know we have our breakthrough page, which is online at breakthroughpeoria.com, or by downloading the tithe.ly app directly to your phone. You can also give there. If you're giving to the building fund, to tithe or offering, that is available online. And of course, if you would like to continue to mail in your blessing, your offering, your tithing, you can mail it to Breakthrough Community Church, 8110 West Peoria Avenue, Suite 110, Peoria, Arizona, 85345. And there in the comments, if you're watching online with us, it has the address directly there in the comments, or you can see our page there on Facebook. Let us just go before the Lord as we prepare this morning. Father, Lord, we just thank you. Thank you again, God, just for your presence. Thank you, God, as you've called us to worship you in spirit and truth. We know part of our worship is our giving. We know part of our worship is our service. We know part of our worship is just to be obedient to you. So this morning, help us, God, to be obedient. Let us not look upon the ocean. Let us not look upon the seas. Let us not look upon the sickness that's going on around many, with many families being afflicted, Father. But let us look upon you. Let us remain obedient this morning. So we ask that you would bless the tithe, bless the offering this morning, bless those that are able, and those that are not able to give this morning, you know their heart. We ask, God, that we would be able to just look upon you and see how you are our provider, how you are our healer this morning. So God, have your way. Holy Spirit, move within this place. Touch every living room, car, park, no matter where we are listening to the word this morning. Touch our hearts. Open us up to receive what you have and help us to be a blessing and obedience to what you've already given us. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. It's good to have you here today. Those that are here this morning and those that are watching via Facebook. And, you know, we gathered together here Friday to pray for your needs. You know, I want you to know that those that are coming to the church, there are very few of us here today, knowing that many of you are not feeling well for whatever reason, whether it be COVID or flu, some are sick right now with pneumonia. It's the season for those things. But know that we're praying for you as a church, that we're interceding for you, and that you are always continually in our prayers. So even for now, you know, I thank God just seeing so many empty seats here today and just mostly doing online. You know, my heart goes out to those who are not well here today. And so just know that your church is praying for you. We're praying for you. The leadership is praying for you. And God will be glorified. Amen. Just like last time when we had a large growth spurt when we opened our doors, I know God is going to do something again the second time around, the last time around. Amen. So let's go ahead and we'll just start this morning's service with a word of prayer. Father, we come before you in the mighty name of Jesus. And Father, we ask this morning that you administer your word to the people that are watching here today, that they may even share it, Father, with someone who is also concerned in these troubled times, Lord God, to press in, to press on, to march forward, Father God, in these uncertain times, Father, for those who don't know you, that they would get to know you even better, Father, here today after this sermon. I pray, Father, that you would comfort those, Father God, that need to be comforted here today. You are the great comforter, Lord God, the mighty comforter, the great healer, Father. So I pray in the name of Jesus that your message would go out forward. It would not fall on any other ground but fertile ground, Father God, here today. So, Father, we give you thanks ahead of time for what you're going to do. We bless you, we praise you, we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, if you're tuning in from home, you can turn your Bibles to Mark chapter 5, verse 24. And a very familiar portion of scripture that we're going to be reading through this morning. Mark chapter 5, verse 24. Now this is concerning the woman with the issue of blood. And Jesus at this point in time had already been with the disciples. He's making his way. Miracles were being performed. He's talking a lot about parables right before this, prior to this. And so what's happening is he's on his way. He's on a mission over to Jairus' house. And something happens. He sees someone on the wayside here. So the word of God reads starting in verse 24. So Jesus went with him. He's talking about Jairus. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all that she had. And instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" "You see the people crowding against you," his disciples answered. "And you ask, who touched me?" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done that. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." Now, you know, for faith to be exercised, a lot of times many of us as Christians, we see faith as kind of a passive exercise. When we're faced with what she was faced with in those days, a lot of times, you know, some people would think, well, I'm in this situation right now where it doesn't look good. But I want to tell you something here this morning, that as long as we take our petitions to Jesus, as long as we take our positions to the Holy Ghost, things will always be good. Things will work out for the better, for our good. Amen? And so, you know, sometimes we think, oh, maybe he's not going to heal me today. Maybe he chose not to heal me at all. Maybe this is something that I need. There's going to be a lot of confusion at times when we don't get what we want in the time frame that we want it. She might have had that thought before going, but she still pressed on and pressed in. You see, when faced with any opposition, people sometimes just back down. They don't like confrontation. And so A lot of times people are going to tell you, you're just going to get more sick, or stay away from this, don't do that, and it's going to cause more fear. The more television I seem to watch, it seems like the more fear that television is trying to instill in people. There's one thing about being safe, there's another thing about living in fear. And we need to remember what God we serve. There's a time now where indifference, especially in the summer, where people are not coming to church and churches are closing their doors, where indifference in the matters of God are going to become the normal. Some people are going to get used to staying home. Some people are going to like the fact that they don't have to come to church anymore. They can watch on TV when it's convenient for them. We have to be aware of those things because God didn't call us to be comfortable, even though He is the great comforter. You see, many people are no longer pursuing God's best for their lives. We need to get back in the press. Amen? The press. The press is where we press in and press on. The gospel lets us know that at times we need a faith that presses in. We need a faith that won't let us wait. She heard the news. Jesus is coming. And what if the word of God says here in verse 27, when she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him. She didn't wait. You see, faith doesn't wait. Faith is an action word. When we have faith, it causes us to move forward. Faith doesn't let us wait. Faith that is willing, we need a faith that is willing to fight for what we need. You know, I know when I was sick last year, I was really, really sick. There are things that go through our head where we just want to give up. We want to give in. But these are the times now, church, where the church has to come in and we have to fight for what we need, for what we want. This is not the time to give up. Some of you that are here today and some of you that are watching today, you are the only person that is interceding for your family, for your friends, for your co-workers, and you need to be that person, that light in a dark time. Amen. We need a faith that God honors. A faith that God honors has to be a supernatural type faith. It's not a regular type of faith. We know tomorrow, we have faith that tomorrow the sun's going to come up. That doesn't take really any faith. That's just a matter of fact. But we have a certain degree of faith that the sun will come up and the sun will go down. But we need supernatural faith in these troubled times. A supernatural faith that whatever these eyes show us, we don't always believe. We cannot always believe what we see with our eyes. And it will take a supernatural type faith to believe in the unseen God. A faith that isn't normal, natural, has to be supernatural. You see, faith that didn't come from her strength, this kind of faith that she had to go see him, didn't come from her. It didn't come from her at all because she didn't really have any faith. She wasn't a believer. All she did was she heard. Are you hearing me this morning? Jesus is real. Amen. Jesus is alive. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end. She had no faith. She stepped forward. She stepped out. She moved from where she was at to get to Him. Amen. Her faith became an action word. We need a faith that doesn't come from religious practices. She wasn't a religious person. She didn't have any religion in her. We need to come as people of God and move past religion. Well, I know I need to do this because this is what I'm told to do, or this is what I feel I should do. We have to move past that to that supernatural faith, believing in the unseen. All faith is from God. You see, this faith was imparted from above. You see, it's God that chose us. We didn't choose Him. So if you're watching here today and you're not serving God, you need to understand that He calls us. Nobody is called. Nobody is called. We are chosen by God. We have to come with this attitude of faith. We have to come with this attitude of faith. Faith with a promise. If I could just touch His clothes, I'm going to be made whole. You see, a lot of times in our mind, we want God to touch us. But do we ever think about touching Him? Do we ever make the effort to go forward to Him, to run after Him? We need that type of faith that has no barriers to it. Her life only knew barriers, where she could go, what she could do. This faith is no longer confined to the possible or impossible. It goes beyond that. That I know whatever my God says is going to happen. And it's going to happen in His time and in His will. He's going to give me the portion that I need. This faith is no longer confined by who has it. Amen? Because some people have a different measure of faith than others. Amen? But it's not confined to that any longer. It's a faith that just sees God, and when He says something, it's done. You don't ask about when, where, why, who. We have so many people that ask all these questions, but when He says it, it is finished.
Amen.
It's done. And He'll work out the time, the when, the who, and the how. Are we willing to surrender our circumstance to this type of faith? Are we willing to give over our sickness, our disease, our shortcomings, our sin to this kind of faith? You see, a lot of us are our own worst enemy. Many of us are our own worst enemy. We don't even have the faith that God can change us. He can change other people just fine, but He knows, I've dealt with this issue since I was little. Do we even have that faith that says, no, I'm going to give it to Him and He's going to keep it. I'm not going to take it back with me. You see, this miracle was a wayside miracle. Jesus was on His way to Jairus' house and would have passed her by if she didn't press in. It's time to get off the sidelines of spirituality. Press in. Time to get where Jesus is moving. He's moving forward. He's always moving forward, and we need to follow Him. Faith will do that. It'll get you out of your seat. It will get you out of your chair. It will get you out of your sickness. It will get you out of disease. It will get you out of anxiety, stress, depression. Faith will do that for us. We have to go where Jesus is. If we want healing, if we want revival, if we want salvation for our family, deliverance, restoration, we have to press in. Not only did she press in, but she pressed through. She pressed through. There's thieves in our lives that steal from us the blessings of God. And just by blocking us from, what they do is they block us from receiving these blessings. And that was like a crowd of people. There was a crowd of people always around Him. And she didn't just press in, but she pressed through the crowds. You see, she wasn't supposed to be around anybody. She wasn't supposed to be close to anybody because she was considered unclean. But see, faith doesn't care about any of that. Her faith, she just saw the end result. The end result is Jesus. She had her eyes fixed and focused on the prize, on the deliverer, the only one who can help. You see, the Bible says here in just this portion of Scripture that she went to the care of many doctors. You see, a lot of times doctors will give you the wrong news. Sometimes they'll give you the right news, but a lot of times they'll give you the wrong news. But we have to remember who the divine healer is, ultimately. Right. Satan can build these walls. We can build these walls. Circumstances can build these walls. Even sincere friends and family can build these walls. And no matter where these walls of hindrance came from, they have to come down. They have to come down. We have to learn to press through the walls. No matter what the obstacles are, no matter what the distractions are right now, there's so many distractions that are going on. I think COVID is just one of the major ones because it's pushed so much on social media, it's on the news, it's everywhere. But there are so many things going on right now in this world. And we have to remember, we have to just press through, press on, press in. In one scene of the popular movie, Robin Hood, the Prince of Thieves, Kevin Costner as Robin Hood comes to a young man taking aim at an archery target. And Robin asks, can you shoot amongst distraction? Just before the boy releases the string, Robin pokes his ear with the feathers and an arrow. And the boy's shot flies high by several feet. After the laughter of those watching dies down, Maid Marian standing by the boy asks Robin, can you? Robin Hood raises his bow and takes aim. Just as he releases the arrow, Maid Marian leans beside him and flirtatiously blows into his face. The arrow misses the target, glances off the tree behind it, and scarcely misses a bystander. You see, distractions come in all forms, in all shapes, in all sizes. And whether they're painful or pleasant, the result is the same. We miss God's mark. We miss the mark. And you see, that's what we're all aiming for, isn't it? The mark. But what happens when distractions come in? I can tell you something right now. The election was a distraction. COVID-19 is a distraction. Influenza is a distraction. Cancer is a distraction. All those things are distractions. They want us to miss the mark. It's the reason why the enemy throws whatever he can at us for that distraction, for us to get off of the mark of the high call of Jesus Christ. But some of these distractions are constant in our life, but they have to be pressed through while keeping our eyes fixed on the target. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 14, the Word of God says this, I press towards the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. So she pressed through. What she pressed through? One of the things she pressed through the sickness. That's what many of us need to do now. We need to press through the sickness. If anyone had an excuse to stay home and stay in bed, it was this woman here. Her illness was fatal. It was her dying slowly. It was a slow death. The Bible says 12 years she had up to this point. Can you imagine being that sick for 12 years? And in those days, they didn't have what we have now. So 12 years was a long time. I'm sure it was constantly just bothering her and making her weak. It was debilitating her. And it made her vulnerable to catch other diseases as well. Kind of like now. Amen? One thing leads to another, it seems, these days. She had to press through sickness. She also had to press through disappointment. Sometimes if somebody doesn't think the way we do, we get disappointed in them. Isn't that something? We get disappointed in people. See, the Bible says that she suffered many things from many different physicians. No doubt a lot of these physicians had given her all these promises. You're going to be okay. We're going to be able to fix you. That the next treatment is going to be the last one. I promise. Now, we can see that it was just taking advantage of her vulnerability. They were overcharging her. Every physician offered her new hope, but every physician had ended their treatment with the same words, we've done everything we can do. Some of you are to the point right now where you feel in your heart, you feel in your mind, you've done everything you can do. I don't know what's left. I don't know what more there is. There's nothing more left that I can do. I've prayed, I've fasted. Well, those are good things to do. Continue to do them. God will come in the perfect time. She's been disappointed many times, but she wouldn't let disappointment get between her and her healing, between her and her God. Nothing stopped her. She may have had many religious people even pray for her, but their unanswered prayers wouldn't get between her and Jesus. Don't let unanswered prayers get in the way, because that's a distraction. And just because God hasn't answered your prayer yet doesn't mean that He will not ultimately answer your prayer. Amen? Some of us need to distinguish sometimes God will just say no. That doesn't mean that He didn't answer your prayer. He answered your prayer with a no. Amen. And we just don't want to accept the no. Amen? Amen. We're like, oh, no, He didn't really mean that one. No, and it's like little kids sometimes, right? Sometimes you tell them no, and they're like, so they're, maybe? Does that mean maybe? Right? The little stubborn kids, I know we all have, if you have more than one kid, you have one of those. If you know what I'm talking about. No means maybe still. And sometimes we get that mentality in Christianity. But sometimes God is saying, no, don't go there, don't do this, don't do that. Well, does that mean maybe? Not now, but later? And we still hold on to something we shouldn't be holding on to, and we need to move on. So she pressed through sickness. She pressed through the disappointment. And now what she has to do is she has to press through the hopelessness. I can't imagine at those times, you know, she probably hit rock bottom at this point, not knowing what to do. You know, back then, if a doctor told you there's nothing they can do, what else was there? She wasn't a religious person. She wasn't a Christian. She wasn't saved. It's like the world right now. They're looking for an answer. We're trying to give it to them. Amen? And some of them just aren't hearing it. She grew worse. Her finances were gone. Many times we've been there. We've been in those places before where the devil just bombards us with one thing after another, after another, after another. It almost seemed like 2020 was a whole year of that for many of you. We have to turn to God. When family can't help, when the banks can't help, when your employers can't help, when your friends can't help, we have to turn to God. That should be the first person that we go to. But many times we put him at the back of the list when he should be the first on the list. She also had to press through the shame. Now, according to the law, she was considered ceremonially unclean because of her disease. So in other words, she was an outcast. People didn't want her around. It's almost kind of like those that were sick with boils and so forth, where they had to ring the bell around and say, unclean, unclean. She was almost in a similar situation. People knew. I'm sure the doctors every once in a while would have a conversation with another patient. Oh yeah, you heard about her? Yeah, she's sick. She's going to be sick for a long time. Nobody can help her. And then the rumors start to spread. So people knew. That's why she was outcast. You know, even everything that she touched was considered unclean. Her condition kept her away from the temple and the worship of Jehovah. Boy, that sounds kind of familiar, doesn't it? A sickness that keeps us away from church. That's what's happening right now in 2020. And if you're ill and sick, please do. Stay away from church. But don't stay away from God. You don't have to stay away from Jesus. There should be no walls or no barriers there. You still need to stay in contact with your God, your Savior, the only one who can actually deliver you and save you and heal you. You see, the devil many times will use shame to make us feel unworthy and unfit to be touched by God. But we have to let the devil know that Jesus doesn't operate on the basis of our worthiness, but on the basis of his grace. Amen? It's not because of who we are. I don't think the devil's very impressed with me being a pastor. Matter of fact, I don't think he's impressed at all. But I do know that he's impressed with our God. Amen? He is impressed with God. He knows who he is. This woman here had to press through the crowd of people. Her greatest obstacle in those days were her neighbors, the people around her. They start looking at each other funny, huh? Oh, here she comes. Here she comes. Watch out. Stay away. She may have thought, well, they needed healing as much as I do, so I'll just wait. I'll just wait. A lot of times we have that mentality that we should be last. No. Stand in line to be first. Amen. When it comes to Jesus, there's enough of him to go around all at one time. Amen. Amen. So many times, and I've been guilty of this so many times, where I pray for other people and I forget to pray for myself. If you're watching here from home today, I want to tell you something. You can lay hands on yourself. You can anoint yourself with oil. You can do all the things that we need to do. It's not always for everybody else. Sometimes it's for us. We need to minister to ourselves. Amen. Mm-hmm. Amen. As a matter of fact, when my wife was ill earlier this year, and we went to the doctor's office, we had a nurse that was Christian. And she said, you know, she told my wife, the Lord is telling me to tell you something. You need to pray over yourself. You need to lay hands on yourself. So I want to encourage you to do that this morning. If you're the only one saved in your home, that may be the only way you get prayer. We're praying for you. But you need to lay hands on yourself. Amen? You need to pray over yourself. Speak life into yourself. Some of her friends were probably there trying to get her to sit and not hurt herself. No, you just need to go over there. Just stay over there. Separate. Separation is one of the worst things you can do. Obviously, if we need to separate for right now, there's a reason. But like I said, we don't want to separate. If you're at home and you're ill and you're watching, I want to encourage you something right now. That doesn't mean you can't call someone and pray over them. You can't text someone, pray over them. You can't go leave them some soup at their front door, let them know, hey, we love you, we're thinking of you. we're still called by God to minister to one another. And just because we're at home and we're not feeling good doesn't mean that we can't still pick up the phone and say, hey, the Lord is going to do something with you here today. He's going to heal you. We're pressing in with you. We're agreeing together in prayer with you. Are we still evangelizing over the phone? Are we still ministering over the phone? It's not just from a pulpit that we do these things, but we do these things at all times. You'd be amazed at what a phone call or a text can do. She pressed in, not only physically and emotionally, but she pressed through, but spiritually she also pressed in. Pressing in is a spiritual matter. It takes us from the norm, the average, to the supernatural. It takes us beyond. As I mentioned last week, we had people come up, and 2 weeks ago we had an amazing altar call. And some people stayed behind even after. I told people, if you want to go, you can go. But for those who want to press in, you can press in. And so people came to the altars, but they didn't stop there. They went from an altar experience to an upper room experience. They went to a holy of holy experience. They went to the next level. Why? Because they pressed in. They moved forward. They got past what they were used to. They wanted to go into the holy of holies. But to do that, you have to press in. You have to press on. It's not just your average everyday prayer that you normally do. It's staying that extra time with God. Amen? Pressing in means I'm willing to get right in the middle of things, not ignore it. Not going to close my eyes to it. But I'm going in with a supernatural faith in a supernatural God. We forget sometimes who it is that we're praying to. You think COVID-19 has something over God? No. The flu? No. Cancer? No. What this woman did was she responded to what she heard. What you hear often determines the outcome of what you do. A lot of times we form an opinion of something just by something we hear. We don't even look up the facts. We form an opinion of somebody by what we hear. Oh, I heard that they were this and that. And we form an opinion. And that's what happened with her. People formed an opinion. Right? She pressed through that. It doesn't matter what you think. It only matters what he thinks.
That's right.
That's all I'm concerned with right now. Amen? Amen. 12 years she heard the wrong things. Negative. Hopeless. But everything changed after she heard the right thing. When she heard the right thing, that's what changed her life. You know, I remember when I heard the right thing. Jesus forgives you of your sin. What a feeling that was. Jesus delivers you from all the things that you've been doing. When I heard the right thing, because I heard a lot of negativity before in my life, because I did it myself, but when I heard the right thing, it caused me to change my life and my lifestyle for 27 years now, because I heard one right thing spoken into me. You're forgiven. You're set free. You're delivered. Jesus said, I've come to make all things new. That's what he wants to do with us, to make us new. Are you tired of being the old person? The old self? He came to make us new. You see, faith comes by hearing. It's the seed of supernatural faith. Paul said it was the reason that many people fell in the wilderness, as a matter of fact. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2, you don't need to go there, but if you're writing notes, in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2, it says this, for unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. Amen? People fell because of that. They just didn't want to accept what God had to say. There was no faith there. That's what happens. We don't have any faith, we'll fall away. Because when our faith is gone, our hope is gone. Our trust is gone. Amen? We need that faith. We need that trust. Without hope, man, I'll tell you something. It doesn't give us anything to look forward to. And without faith, the Bible says it's impossible. Not hard. It's impossible to please God. We have to remember that even in this time, especially in this time, we need to screen what we allow our hearts to receive. We have to be careful what things are being said or spoken to into our lives. Well, some of us screen our calls, right? You guys ever screen your calls? You're looking, you're like, hey. I'm not going to answer that phone call, right? Or I already know, or you see a scam likely, right? You're like, yeah, no. The last one, what we, a lot of us were getting, I'm sure many of you got it as well, political call. We screen those real quick, right? We need to screen our calls to see if we want to hear from that person on the other end. We need to screen our conversations even with sincere believers at times. Amen. One of the things that I love about this woman was she declared what she believed. You see, many times church people have become church proof. It doesn't matter what word is preached, it's just going to pass through our lives or their lives without ever making a difference. They're going to hear the word. They're not going to allow it to be internalized in them. They're going to hear it, and that's just that. They're like, those are the people that say, that was a good message for you. Or I know somebody that could really benefit from this message here. I'm going to forward this to them. But see, every message is for every single one of us. Because the word of God doesn't come back void. Amen. Faith is positive talk. But faith talk isn't denial of our condition. It's declaring God is greater than the need that we have. That's what faith is. It's not turning a blind eye to what's going on, but it's just saying, no, God is greater than what I'm going through right now. He is able. He is willing. You see, she wasn't talking to other people. She was talking to herself. If we're not careful, we can at times talk ourselves out of a miracle. I've seen it. I've seen it done before. Sometimes our biggest cheerleader has to be ourselves. Sometimes everybody else, the closest one next to you, kids, family, church, doesn't matter. We have to declare ourselves. Lord, I'm going to declare this time to you. Listen to you only. There's seasons for that. She was moved by action. Faith demands action. We must act on faith or silence what it's saying. What she believed demanded that she got out of bed. Just the very fact that she got up that day, heard, and then went. It doesn't say, oh, she went and did the dishes first. She did this. No. As soon as she heard, she was there. She was right there by the crowd. There's a short story of a man who once inherited a map that he was very proud of. This map gave directions to where a jar was buried containing several thousand dollars. He spoke of this map to his friends, but during the course of his life, he never tried to find the treasure. When he died, his grandson, gripped by the spirit of adventure, obtained the map. He followed its instructions, and to his surprise, he found $20,000 in rare coins. And it sounds kind of foolish a lot, you know, that he would never go and obtain it or try and look for it. But Christians do that every Sunday. We sing about Jesus, we preach about Jesus, and we proudly display the map, which is God's word, but we don't follow it to the feet of Jesus and never even reach out to touch him.
Come on.
We don't reach out to touch him. We wait for him always to touch us, but we need to touch him. That's what she did. That's how she got her miracle. He was walking in a whole different direction. She came up behind him and touched his cloak. She went to him. I'm not going to just let those people over there get blessed. I need a blessing. I need a healing. I need salvation. I need deliverance. And I'm going to go get it. When you wanted something bad enough before you got saved,
well, come on.
How far did you go to get it? We went out of our way to get certain things. If there's a sale, Black Friday, we wait in lines.
Well.
We wait in lines. My son, you know, he waits in a line. I think one time he waited 2 days for a new PS, whatever number they were on at that time, 3, 4, 5, I don't know. But when we want something bad enough, we go and we wait until we get it. Why is it so different in the spirit realm? Why is it so different when things concern Jesus? We don't want to wait. We don't want to go and stand. We don't want to make the effort to go forward. She pressed in. She pressed on. We give the doctors the faith that we don't give to Jesus many times. She didn't get in the press long enough to see him. She didn't get in the press long enough to feel his presence. She pressed on until she touched him. We get so close to a breakthrough and then we walk away. Now is the time to press in and press on. We have to press on what is no longer convenient for us. Well, sometimes I know people won't even go, they'll settle for a church they really are not excited about simply because it's close to them. But it's not spirit-filled. Amen? They won't travel to a church where they can go and meet God along with other believers in fellowship and worship the King.
Amen.
They do that because they like the convenience. We like the convenience of things. Oh, it's close by. It's only 3 minutes from my house. I can go walk in right as soon as worship is over. They have it down to the minute. Missing worship altogether, one of the most important parts, just as important to me as the sermon in itself.
Amen.
Ushering in the presence of God. That's like the invitation, Holy Spirit, be here.
Yes.
So that you can minister, so that my heart can be open to understand what's even being said. So that seed can take root in my heart. We need to usher in that presence. But some of us, we don't even want to travel 10, 15, 20 minutes to go have a meeting with God. Yes, I know we can do that from home. But that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the things that we do are out of convenience.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? She went beyond what was popular. Many won't understand or will they even appreciate it. The most powerful prayer warriors will tell you this is one of the greatest keys to an effective prayer life. Going past the comfort zone, even to what's dangerous at times. She went knowing that people might ridicule her, maybe even stone her. She didn't care. I just want to meet with Jesus. I just need to touch the hem of his garment. That's all I need. She wanted to touch him. I believe that she touched him with one finger on the hem of his garment so that he would not be made unclean by this act. It was all that she could do lawfully by the law. Just touch the hem of his garment. That's the closest she could get to. Many times we look at getting a blessing, but she considered Jesus. She wasn't in it for what she could get. She just wanted to be close to the miracle-working God, the Savior. You know, I think about that sometimes, and sometimes I think, do I want to get close to God, or do I want Him to answer my prayer and hear my cry? We have to ask ourselves that question sometimes. Do I just want to be close to Jesus? Because once you're close to Jesus, those things will take place anyways. But it's the matter of the heart. That's why the Bible says that we come boldly before the throne. We come boldly because we know who we're going to. But a lot of times, our motive has to be checked. Are we coming here just to be in His presence, to be close to Him? Or is it because we want something? Because we need something. He knows our needs. He's the supplier of all our needs, right? According to His riches, according to His glory.
Amen.
And you know what I love about this is Jesus knows when we break through all those things. He knows when we break through. When she touched Him, it was as if time stood still, like a freeze frame in a movie. The moment that she was pregnant with power, it came through her, came to her, took over her emotions, love, all those things started to come into play. Not only did she feel something, but Jesus felt something. He turned around and see if I can see exactly what it says here. In verse 30, it says here, at once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. Are you ready for power to go out from Jesus to you? You have to go after him. You have to go to him. Press through, break through, press on. She felt healing virtue immediately. He felt the despair, the hopelessness, the fear, the pain. He felt all of those things. But he felt power leaving him. I can only imagine, he's walking around, he has all these people with him. And all of a sudden he goes like this. And if you think about that, that act in itself right there, what she must have thought as soon as she touched him. He saw me. He paid attention to me.
Yes.
He felt what I felt because it came from him directly to me. Nobody had to go lay hands. Nobody had to pray. Yes. Nobody had to do anything. I made this effort and he saw me.
Yes.
Are you ready to be seen by God? Are you ready to have the attention of God himself in the flesh? Jesus.
Man.
This morning. That's why I say we pray for ourselves. Pray over ourselves. She felt healing virtue immediately. He also felt the power of her faith, that supernatural faith that comes from him and him alone. That's what we need to reach out for today. That's what we need to extend our hand out to today, is that type of faith that she had. She didn't give up.
That's right.
Many want to give up right now. Many have so many other things aside from what's going on in the world. You have these personal issues in your life, your family issues, your work issues, financial issues. All these things are taking place. They're piling up one on top of another. But you need to break through all those things and just touch the hem of his garment. Reach out to him this morning. He stopped that entire mob of people to announce to everyone that this shy woman had broken through to her miracle. We need to press in, church, during this time, this crucial time, if I could have the worship team come up, until heaven is stopped to see this miracle take place. I know that there's needs in the house this morning. I know that there's needs in your homes this morning. But if we could just remember that a touch from the Master really is all we need. But we need that faith to be able to go to him. Don't just ask him to touch you. Let's try and touch him today. They're going to play a song in a moment here. And if you're at home watching or if you're here today, I know there's very few of us here today, I want to encourage you this morning. Reach out to him. Reach out to him today. Touch him today. One of the other times that I love is when Stephen was being martyred, when he was being killed, stoned to death. The Bible says that Jesus, who sits at the right hand of the Father, stood up. Got the attention of God. He stood up. Now, every time you see scripture talking about Jesus, it says he sits at the right hand of the Father. But this time when Stephen was giving his all, his everything, his life, his problems, he had a problem right there at that moment, didn't he? He was being stoned, buried up to his neck and rocks thrown at him. And God stands up. Jesus stood up. He points down from heaven. He touched Jesus with his act of faith. Forgive them. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's where our hearts need to be this morning, church. Our hearts need to be right with God, to where he is the single most important thing in our life. He is more important than what the doctors say, more important what our spouses even say, more important what our friends and family say. He is the source of righteousness. He is the source of truth. He is the source of healing. This morning, we need to touch him today. If you would stand with me for those who are here this morning. If you're at home right now, I want you to stand as well. Remember that we're praying for you still. We haven't forgotten you. We pray for you by name. By name. So I just pray, Father, this morning, in the name of Jesus, before we sing the song, Father, that there be those here today, Father, that have a need that they brought before you. They're still stressed. They're still anxious. They're still doubting. But I pray over them right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, that as we sing this song, Father, that you would bring a calm spirit to them. That power would leave you and go to them this morning, Father. We declare it in the name of Jesus. Your healing virtue be sent to them, Father, as we sing here today. In the mighty name of Jesus, Holy Spirit, have your way. Have your way. Father, we give our petitions over to you this morning, that you would heal the sick, Lord. Father, I pray over them in the mighty name of Jesus for a hedge of protection upon them, Lord God. Whose report will we believe? We will believe the report of the Lord this morning. Father, I pray over them. If there's anything, Father God, that is coming against them spiritually, physically, mentally and emotionally, even financially, Father, I pray that you cover them this morning and that their faith would be in you. Help them this morning and give them the strength, Father, I pray, to press in, to press on towards the mark of the high call. Father, I thank you ahead of time for what you're going to do. For we know, Father, soon that there will be testimonies, Father God, of your goodness through these troubled times. We bless you here. We praise you here. And we worship you, Father. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you this morning. We hope to see you.